Bob's tenure as Ambassador Riyadh coincided with my own in Islamabad on that fateful day of 9/11/2001. And from one day to the next, the diplomatic mission in Islamabad and in Riyadh went from being a very important mission to being two of the most intense diplomatic relations in the world as we wrestled with Washington on Al-Qaeda and the terrorism and our policies towards it and our reactions towards it. Fortunately, Bob has reflected on his experience, and he's written a very engaging account of his experience. The book is a very good read. We'll be selling it at the back, limited copies, but we will be selling it. It's available. It's an extremely engaging read. It is accessible to those people who are not experts or a little background on the Arab Peninsula, or for you youngsters have no detailed memory of those days. It's now been 15 years. But it's also extremely rewarding for professionals of national security and political junkies. Highly recommend it. I'm not going to say much more because I don't want to steal Bob's thunder. But I can offer just a little teaser. The book describes vividly, on a very personal level, how senior Saudis interacted with President Bush and his senior staff. You'll find that Bob is a very insightful observer, both of Saudi society, but also of the political intricacies back here in Washington, D.C. And what I liked about it was his appreciation for the interworkings of an embassy and for his staff and for his career foreign service staff, which I am a part of. So it's my pleasure to introduce Robert Jordan. He is currently now an adjunct professor of political science at the John G. Tower Center at Southern Methodist University in Dallas. Bob was a partner for many years in Baker Botts in Dallas, but most recently he headed the office in Abu Dhabi. It's my very good fortune to also say that Bob is vice chairman of the board of the Middle East Institute. So please welcome Robert Jordan.
Ambassador Chamberlain, thank you very much. You know, hearing the name Robert Ford reminds me of something. Robert Ford is a friend of mine. I know Robert Ford, and I can assure you I am no Robert Ford. Before I get started, I want to make note of the passing yesterday of a true giant in the world of diplomacy, Prince Saud Al-Faisal, the longtime serving Minister of Foreign Affairs of Saudi Arabia. Prince Saud was an outstanding figure, transcending many administrations, many kings, many issues dealing with the Middle East. He was a great friend of America. When I arrived right after 9/11, when a number of senior royals were in denial that 15 of the 19 hijackers could have been Saudis, Prince Saud stepped up, acknowledged the problem, acknowledged the issues of extremism that we had to deal with, and worked tirelessly with us and American interests to try to make some progress. So we're going to miss him. The world is better for his having served, and I just wish he were still around. You know, I was an innocent lawyer in Dallas, Texas, minding my own business when my friend, the President of the United States, George W. Bush, asked me to become ambassador to Saudi Arabia. And I've had a lot of people say, why you? And I've asked myself that question. And here's how it worked. The Saudis have a deal with the United States. They refuse to give agremant or diplomatic credentials to a career foreign service officer. And so people like Wendy Chamberlain and others would have been terrific in the job, but the Saudis wanted someone who was a close personal friend of the president, who could go over the heads of the bureaucracy, who could get the White House on the phone, and who didn't frankly have a career to protect. And so that was my currency. And the president asked me to do this in about April of 2001. And I had a very happy law practice at Baker Botts in Dallas. I had a very nice situation there that I wasn't very anxious to walk away from. I also had three sons to put through college. But I was pondering it. I actually took quite a while to think about it. And one day, my son Peter, who was home on spring break from Duke University, turned to me and said, "You know, Dad, when your friend, the President of the United States, asks you to serve your country, you really can't say no, can you?" And I said, "I know, Peter, that's exactly right, and that's what I'm going to do. I'll go forward." But I had a conversation with Andy Card, who was the Chief of Staff of the White House, and he knew I was having a hard time deciding what to do, and he said, "Well, Bob, can you do it for a year?" And I said, "Well, sure, I can do anything for a year." And at that point, he knew he had me. So I signed on for a year. And then he said, "Anything that you do on the plus side, on beyond a year, will simply consider on the plus side." So I stayed, ended up staying 2 years. And I arrived about 3 weeks after the attacks of September the 11th. We had planned that I would go to Arabic language school here before going over there. This was at a time when we thought my confirmation hearing would probably be in January of 2002. But because of the attacks, the chairman of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee, Joe Biden, offered a deal in which if he would give us a very quick confirmation hearing if myself and other colleagues would go off to our posts immediately and not stay behind for language training or further consultations. And so that was how I found myself on an airplane in mid-October in the middle of the night landing in Riyadh. I landed in Riyadh, and Riyadh is a large town, but not a lot of skyscrapers. It's very spread out, but you can see the lights below. I landed, saw the airline terminal, and I saw the tower next to it, which I was certain was an air traffic control tower. It turns out it was a mosque, and a minaret from the airport mosque. I was then met by my six new best friends, my Saudi bodyguards. And this is another myth, I think, that a lot of people believe that the U.S. Marines are actually the ambassador's bodyguards. In a number of embassies, they don't really have bodyguards, or they certainly didn't at that time. But the Saudis and the Americans made a deal, and the Saudis provided bodyguards for me, and the Americans provided American bodyguards for Prince Bandar bin Sultan, the Saudi ambassador to the U.S. Being right after 9/11, of course, one of the big issues that we were all confronting was whether the Saudis were friend or foe. And I asked myself the same question with regard to the bodyguards. How safe am I? What's this going to be? Can I trust these guys? And fortunately, as it turned out, they were extremely loyal. They would have taken a bullet for me. They did everything they could to protect me, in some cases, to an extreme. For an example, I made a number of friends, Saudi friends, in Saudi Arabia during the time I was there, and one of them was a family in Jeddah, and they had a lovely house on the water, and they had a sailboat, and those of you who know me know I'm an avid sailor. Well, we went out on the boat, but my regional security officer insisted that the bodyguards, at least three of them, go along with me. Well, that was going to cramp my style enormously. So we decided to rent a small fishing boat for them to follow along behind. And I set the rule that they had to be 500 meters back. And so we set out. It was a fairly choppy day. And I look back, and it turns out these bodyguards are not sailors. In fact, they're Bedouins. They had probably never been on a boat before. And I look back, and they're all throwing up over the side in the choppy water. And that was my awakening, I guess, to the extent to which they would go with me on some of my outings. I tried to play golf there a few times, bad golf, in Riyadh, And I would also see them off in the distance looking up at the plateaus above the golf course, waiting to see if they could find any snipers up in the hills of the plateaus. They were terrific guys, and I still see Captain Abdullah every now and then when I'm back in Riyadh, and he's still a very strong figure there. Getting back to my arrival after the attacks of 9/11, and I go into this in great detail in the book. When I first arrived, I called on some of the senior Saudi royals, starting with the governor of Riyadh, Prince Salman, who of course now is the king. His first remarks to me were that these attacks could not have possibly involved Saudis. The 15 of the hijackers could not have been Saudis. It had to have been an Israeli plot. The Mossad had to have done this. And I'll have to tell you, I was just speechless at that point. I then went on to see Prince Nayef, the Minister of Interior, and he had the same story. This had to have been a Mossad plot. It was only when I got to Prince Saud, the foreign minister, that I actually got a straight answer, and it was he knew there were 15 hijackers were Saudis. He knew that they had a problem, and he was committed to working with us to eliminate the extremism, to deal with the terrorists, and to find them and root them out. Well, as it turned out, it was a difficult task to work with the Saudis in these initial days after 9/11. We would give them lists of suspects to round up and interrogate. They wouldn't allow us to interrogate with them. And they wouldn't give us information right away on the results of the interrogations. They wouldn't give us the what we call the pocket litter, the things that they found in their pockets and their cell phones. They wouldn't give us the hard drives on their computers. And so we had a real problem. And we had both the FBI and the CIA working to identify suspects, bring them in, and see who they were and who they knew and what their involvement was. And it really became a tremendous problem. Over time, I will say, we got increasing measures of cooperation. Crown Prince Abdullah was very committed to helping us. Prince Nayef and his son Mohammed bin Nayef, now the Crown Prince, were also extremely helpful in changing the culture in a way so that we could deal more directly with the working level police and Ministry of Interior figures in Saudi Arabia. We had our own problems as well. And I go into this in the book. It's very important for us to recognize that that we don't have all the answers either. I found my own government to be dysfunctional in many ways. I would go in, the CIA asked me to go get some information from Mohammed bin Nayef, which they had been asking for several months and hadn't received. And so they decided to kick it up to me, and I went in, I sort of stormed into his office and I said, "Where's this information? We simply have to have it. This has gone on too long." He said, "Oh, we gave that to the FBI 2 months ago." And so I had to circle back to Bob Mueller and George Tenet and try to figure out a way for them to play nice with each other, because they had a silo mentality just as much as the Saudis did, and it was just as much of a problem. And there was a culture that existed at that time, particularly in the FBI, of not really being comfortable operating in foreign countries, and particularly a foreign country like Saudi Arabia. They had very few Arabic speakers in the FBI at that time. They didn't like living there. They did not send their best and brightest. These were people they couldn't figure out what to do with in some cases. And so they would end up unhappy in Riyadh, going through the motions in many ways, and that culture absolutely had to change. I will say that Bob Mueller was a good listener, and I think ultimately was able to make some changes and show some improvement. But it was a real struggle. I would try to get him and George Tenet in the same room occasionally so we could hash these issues out. They were, again, very cooperative with me, but it took much, much longer than it should have for us to get a functional relationship going in Saudi Arabia with them. The issue of extremism is also something that I deal with in the book, and it's a tough one. It's one that really, of course, underpins a lot of the problems that we had at the time in Saudi Arabia and even extending up to today. I was very concerned that we had to find a way to encourage the Saudis to want to make some changes. It needed to be up to them. They had to embrace it, or it wasn't going to work. We couldn't simply point our finger at them and tell them what we wanted them to do. So I noticed and had learned that the Saudis for a couple of years had been trying to get into the World Trade Organization, the WTO. But there had been some disconnects during the Clinton administration. They had pretty much broken off discussions in October of 2000, I think partly because the Saudis were making demands that were inconsistent with the arrangements with the WTO and the requirements for membership. But it occurred to me that if we could find a way for the Saudis to make the economic reforms that were necessary to qualify for membership in the WTO, we would have a series of things happen. They would reform their economic rules, their commercial laws, their insurance laws. They would eliminate, to some degree, the exclusive distributorships, which had been the purview of the merchant class. We would have more employment opportunities for Saudis, including Saudi women. They would have to meet international standards of commerce, and they would have to essentially come to the party in terms of being a major modern economy. And so I decided what we had to do was escalate this to a political level. If we simply stuck with the U.S. Trade Representative's office, it wasn't going to happen. They were exhausted, they had a small staff, and they had other countries that were really much more cooperative in passing the legislation they needed to qualify. So I went to Washington, I had talked with Condi Rice, I had talked with Colin Powell, and they were very supportive of this idea. I went in to see the Vice President, Vice President Cheney, and he was very receptive. I then went to see Don Evans, who was the Secretary of Commerce. And he was extremely interested and cooperative as well. Armed with this support, I then circled back to Bob Zelick, who was the U.S. Trade Representative, whose office was going to have to do the heavy lifting on this. And I said, okay, Bob, we've got the White House, we've got the Secretary of State, Secretary of Commerce, the Vice President, all in favor of this. What do you think? Can we get this done? And I think he knew at that point that it was imperative that he make some staff resources available, and he did, and it got done, although not nearly as rapidly as I had hoped. One of the issues that came up was whether the Saudis would be required to import pork and alcohol. This was a big myth that somehow they would have to import this, and even their Minister of Commerce at the time was spouting this story. I went to Crown Prince Abdullah finally, and I said, we're not getting anywhere with your Minister of Commerce. He's putting a monkey wrench in this deal. This is just not going to work. Well, over the course of the next few weeks or months, Crown Prince Abdullah fired this minister and brought in Abdullah Al-Reza as the Minister of Commerce, a very savvy member of a leading merchant family in Jeddah. Abdullah could not have been more cooperative, and we got it done. It wasn't done by the time I left office, but I was sitting back in Dallas in my law office in 2005, 2 years later, and the phone rings. And it was Jim Oberwetter, who was my successor as ambassador of Saudi Arabia. And Jim says, Bob, I'm here in the office of the U.S. Trade Representative in Washington. We are here signing up the Saudi accession to the WTO, and I just want to pass the phone around the room and let everyone here congratulate you on what you got started. Now, this tells you a lot more about Jim Oberwetter than it tells you about anyone else. But it is something that happened, and since those days, the foreign direct investment in Saudi Arabia has increased dramatically. There are more jobs. It's got a long way to go. There are more women participating. Again, a long, long, long way to go. But there has been progress. And so I think this is something that we can look to the future with some hope about. I certainly hope so. I try not to deal exclusively with policy in the book. There are some good times and some bad times. I had a group of friends, which we called the Friday Group, Friday being our day off. We would get together at one of our residences and play tennis or swim or have a few adult beverages from time to time. And it really was one of those life-saving moments where you can make friends and you can call kind of a timeout from the stress of dealing what we were dealing with every day. I really, to this day, greatly fondly remember those wonderful people in the Friday group. We also had issues dealing with the religious police, the Matawa. Of course, it's their job to make sure that particularly Saudis and other Muslims are going into the mosques during the five times a day prayer times, and that the shops are closing. And it's also their job to make sure that there isn't inappropriate dress on the streets, particularly with women. And this raised issues from time to time. As many of you know, Saudi women are not really allowed to be in the company of another man if they're not married, and they have to be accompanied by their closest male relative when they're in mixed company. Well, my son Andrew was 19 at the time. He had taken a gap year after graduating from high school before he started college at NYU. And he came out to Riyadh and made friends with some local people. And one of them was friends with two Saudi teenage girls. And so they arranged to meet the girls in the restaurant, the Harvey Nichols restaurant, at the Faisaliyah shopping mall in Riyadh. So they go in and they sit down and start having lunch. Tom knows what's going to happen here. And there was a signal that the Faisaliyah had to let people know when the Matawa were coming. They played a certain tune on the sound system in the restaurant, and that was the alert, the call to arms. And so they heard it, the boys are warned, they jump up, jump to another table. Matawa come in, go up to the girls and say, are you sitting with boys? And they say, oh, no, it's just the two of us. They look down, of course, and see the four place settings, some half-eaten food, looked at the boys and said, come with us. And I think Andrew was probably shaking in his boots at that time. So they take him out on the hallway, start sternly lecturing them, grab their identification cards, and luckily Andrew had a diplomatic identification card, which got him off and got him a free pass to go back home. So he tells me the story. About 2 days later, I'm in the lobby of the Faisaliyah Hotel, and I'm talking with Adil Al-Jaber, the Crown Prince's foreign policy advisor, who of course now is the new foreign minister of Saudi Arabia. In his company was this flaming red-haired reporter for the New York Times named Maureen Dowd. Many of you have read her columns. And I'm just conversing and telling this story about Andrew and the Matawa. Maureen is wearing a black turtleneck and a long black skirt, but no abaya and no hair covering. She then says, I want to go out into the mall and get busted by the Matawa. So sure enough, she chases out of the mall. Adil is kind of following behind her, and within seconds, the Matawa have her in custody. And they have her detained, and they have a very stern look on their faces. And Adil comes up and with some persuasion, explains to them that they better let her go, and she's a guest of the Crown Prince, and this better be taken care of. Well, sure enough, the next day in the New York Times, Maureen has her column. And her column is about being busted by the Matawa in Saudi Arabia. The interesting thing is she does show a certain amount of understanding about women's issues, and just I think within the last year, she's written another column about Saudi Arabia in which she notes that there actually has been some progress for women in the kingdom. But there's never a dull moment. We had other issues coming up, and not all of them ended successfully. There's a terrible situation in Saudi Arabia that involves American women marrying Saudi men. Usually they meet them here at university in the United States. They'll get married, they'll have kids, and then often they'll move back to Saudi Arabia, often then under the watchful eye of the mother-in-law, and it doesn't go so well, and the relationship ends in divorce, and the American woman loses custody of her children. And this was something that many people came to me about during the time. There were just some tragic stories about what was happening. And I'm sitting in my office in Riyadh one day, and the phone rings. And I answer it, and I hear the other line, "Mr. Ambassador? Yes, this is Ross Perot." And sure enough, it was Ross Perot Sr., and he had heard about the plight of these women and had in fact, without my knowledge, been helping some of these women over the years, contributing money for travel, for legal expense, for investigations. He had done an amazing job, very, very quietly, never wanted any publicity. He's probably going to be unhappy that I write about him in the book. This was something that he was doing as an amazing public service. And so he had actually detailed his right arm, a guy named Harry McKillop. And Harry McKillop, if you ever read the story about the rescue of the hostages in Iran, was one of the commandos who went in the raid to rescue the hostages. And he, at this time, was about 80-some years old, I suspect. But he said, "You call Harry night or day, and he'll do what he can to help you." Luckily, I didn't learn much about some of the operations they undertook. But they were able to get a few women out, a few kids out. But the story continues. I continue to this day to hear stories of the loss of relationships of American women who have divorced Saudi husbands, and the kids are caught in the middle. They typically stay with the husband. They lose memory of the mother in many cases. They lose their English language skills. And it continues to this day to be a very sad and serious issue that I think we all need to take note of. The night of May 12th, 2003, is a night that I will never forget. That night, three Western housing compounds were attacked by Al-Qaeda suicide bombers. I was home about 10:30 that night, and I got a call from Margaret Scobie, who was my deputy. And she said that the Al-Hamra compound had been hit. Many casualties, Americans, Saudis, other Muslims as well. And then she called back 10 minutes later, and two other compounds had been hit, the Vanel compound and the Jadawal compound. I got in my car, raced to the embassy, convened our emergency action team, and of course we're trying to decide if there were further attacks likely that night, what was our security situation. We went into lockdown, we canceled school for the American kids the next day, and we're trying to assess what was going on. And as I was sitting there taking stock, my blood began to boil. Because 3 weeks earlier, I had received intelligence information that Al-Qaeda, for the first time, was contemplating an attack on Western interests in Saudi Arabia, even though they had been receiving a lot of financial support from individual Saudis in the kingdom. At that time, I sent a letter to the Minister of Interior, Prince Nayef, asking for more security for the Western housing compounds. No response. I sent another letter. No response. And so when May the 12th came, I was really beside myself with anger at the failure to respond to these requests. And so the next day, I went to see Crown Prince Abdullah. And it just happened that that morning, Colin Powell was also arriving on a previously scheduled trip. So he and I went in to see the Crown Prince, and the Crown Prince was white as a sheet. He turned to me and he said, "Mr. Ambassador, I owe you an apology. It was I who decided that you didn't need the additional security at these housing compounds, and I was wrong. But I can assure you that we will capture or kill these terrorists," if they hadn't already killed themselves. "We will find the others, we will find the people they conspired with, and we will treat them just as harshly as the attackers, and we will treat just as harshly even anyone who tries to justify these murders." And sure enough, at that point, the Saudis launched a counterterrorism campaign, the likes of which we had not seen. They finally realized that their state of denial was a fiction. They realized that Al-Qaeda was rampant in their midst, and that something had to be done about it in a very aggressive way. Even the population was so disgusted by these killings that they started cooperating with the Ministry of Interior and the police in a much better way. They would allow entry into their homes. They would turn in suspects who they thought the police needed to know about. And over the next two or three years, we saw a lot of shootouts in Saudi Arabia. This wasn't evidence necessarily that Al-Qaeda was getting more active. It was actually evidence that the police and the Ministry of Interior were getting more active in infiltrating these cells and going after them in an aggressive way. And after this period, they pretty much had removed Al-Qaeda from Saudi Arabia. Now, of course, a lot of them went on to Yemen, and that's another story that we can deal with. But I will say that at that time, the Saudis proved to be very strong partners, especially Mohammed bin Nayef again, and going after these terrorists. This was something that that very much needed to be done. When I first arrived in Saudi Arabia, there was a USO troop coming out to entertain our military troops at the Eskon Village military compound. And it was Drew Carey and his improv troupe. I think it was called Whose Line Is It Anyway? When they knew that I was in the audience, they pulled me up on stage and made a little bit of a victim of me, I guess, put me on a stool and started trying to compose a song about me. So they asked me, what do I like to do? Well, I like to play golf, I like to watch football, and so forth. So they made up this song, which they called the Golfing Badassiter. Fast forward about a year and a half to the month or so before we invaded Iraq. I was invited by General Buzz Moseley to go up on an AWACS mission up to the border of Iraq while one of our fighter planes took out an Iraqi radar installation that had actually fired on one of our planes about 3 days earlier. An AWACS is like a Boeing 707. It's a huge plane, four engines, and it has the big dish on top of it. And I don't know, there were about 12 or 13 of us, I guess, on the plane. And they gave me a flight suit. I went out to the airstrip and I put on this flight suit. And of course, every flight suit has your name badge on it. Well, my name badge said Badassiter Jordan. And they had actually remembered for the last year and a half the name that Drew Carey had given me. It was an amazing time, and also a shocking time in a way for me to see even further evidence of the dysfunctionality of our own government. And I'll close this part with this story, which I tell in more detail in the book. In April of 2002, the president invited Crown Prince Abdullah to come for a summit meeting at his ranch in Crawford, Texas. Well, the Crown Prince asked me, why am I being invited to this ranch? Why am I not invited to the White House? And I explained to him that only one other head of state had ever been invited to the ranch, that this was a huge personal honor to be invited to the president's own personal home, and that it was a sign of his deep respect for the Crown Prince. Well, he bought that, and that was okay. But he was hesitant to go because, as you may recall, at that time we were in the midst of the Second Intifada. The Palestinian-Israeli issue was hot as it could be. Yasser Arafat was being held captive by the Israelis at his headquarters in Ramallah. There was a siege at the Church of the Nativity in Bethlehem. And pictures every day in the Arab newspapers showed dead Palestinian children and women. And the carnage was really getting Abdullah's attention, and he was thinking of not going. He finally decided to go and to take with him a videotape of some of the casualties that had been suffered in the hands of the Israelis so that he could vividly show the president what the problem was and continue to urge him to do something more about it. So Colin Powell and I met the Crown Prince at an airstrip outside of Waco, Texas. He flew in his 747, was greeted, by the way, by some 80-year-old retired Aramco secretaries who had been flown up from Houston to give him flowers as he came down the ramp. And Powell turns to me and says, Bob, this summit meeting is not going to go very well. I just can tell this is going to be a big blow up. So just be ready. Well, typically when you go to Crawford, you go by helicopter from this airstrip if you have flown in there. But the Crown Prince doesn't like to go by helicopter. He doesn't trust helicopters, didn't trust helicopters. So he rented a huge over-the-road bus, a tour bus with filigree and decals and big leather seats. You would have thought it was Dolly Parton going on tour. And so we climb into this bus, and Powell says, and by the way, Bob, after this summit blows up or breaks up, I'm not coming back on the bus with you. I'm staying behind in Crawford to do a press conference with the president, so you're going to be on your own. Great. So off we go. The crown prince is up, sitting shotgun in the front seat, chain-smoking cigarettes and looking at the beautiful Texas countryside in April. And Prince Saud turns to Colin Powell as we're driving along these beautiful flowery vistas and says, what are those flowers there? And Powell, without batting an eye, says, oh, that's alfalfa. And I said, no, I think that's actually bluebonnets, Mr. Secretary. And Saud, without batting an eye, turns to Powell and says, you grew up in New York. What do you know about alfalfa? So there was a little bit of banter back and forth, but it was generally a solemn bus ride to Crawford. And sure enough, as we got there, it turns out the Saudis had given a list of 8 demands for the president to respond to regarding the Israeli-Palestinian issue, releasing Arafat from Ramallah, ending the siege at the Church of the Nativity, and so forth. But as it turned out, the president knew nothing about these 8 demands. And I turned to Bandar and asked him, and he said, well, I took them to the White House and was told the vice president's office was going to handle this. Well, apparently they handled it by not telling the president about it. He was not amused. And we were about to have a complete walkout by the Saudis at this summit. So then, to his credit, the president turns to Abdullah and says, let's go for a ride in my pickup truck. And so he took him outside to his Ford F-250 pickup truck. And I've taken this ride with the president. He's very proud of his ranch. You jump in. They had the interpreter in the seat behind them, the jump seat. And off they went to tour the ranch. Well, they came back about 45 minutes later, and they're beaming like they're now best friends. And sure enough, they had had a really great conversation. I think they had related each other on a personal level, which President Bush was always very good at doing. They came back in. We were able to make some calls to the Israelis and others to get some of these issues handled. But again, I'm sitting there just mystified that here's the President of the United States at a major summit meeting, and the staff work had not been done to brief him on what it was that the people coming to the summit meeting were expecting. So at any rate, we breathed a huge sigh of relief. Powell stayed behind. I got back on the bus with Abdullah, Bandar, and Saud. And you could see that they were visibly relieved. They were literally exhaling. We got on the bus, and they started singing Broadway show tunes to each other. From My Fair Lady, it was like, why can't a woman be like a man? And The Rain in Spain falls mainly in the plain. And again, as a lawyer in Dallas, Texas, 2 years earlier, who could have imagined experiencing something like this as well? It's stranger than fiction, but sure enough, it happened. I would go on and on, but I would really want to leave time for your questions or comments. It was a real exciting time for me there. It was a front row seat to history. The book is an easy read. It's about 220 pages, good for the beach. But I really want to acknowledge my collaborator, Steve Pfeiffer. I was struggling with writing this book for a number of years, and I would do research, and I would get on the internet, and I had stacks and stacks of files. And I finally realized I was writing this like a term paper. But no, it needed to be my story. And I was talking with a friend in Dubai who is a writer, among other things, and he said, you know, there's this guy who helped Jim Baker write his memoir, a guy named Steve Pfeiffer. You ought to look him up. He's really good at helping kind of put stuff together. So I called up Secretary Baker, who was my law partner, and sure enough, he thought the guy was terrific. I had read the book. It was an excellent book. And so I called up Pfeiffer, ended up hiring him. He lived in Chicago, and so I shipped him all of my boxes of stuff, and he would then call me once a week on Skype, and we would talk. He'd record it, turn it into draft chapters. I would do heavy edits. Then I drafted probably the last three chapters mostly on my own. But Steve added such granular detail that I think he's made the book much more interesting. He would say to me, when you go to the White House, what parking lot do you go into? What kind of badge do they give you? When you saw the president in the Oval Office, was he wearing his suit coat or just in shirt sleeves? The things that help paint a picture. And I'll be always grateful to Steve for having helped me really make it a living, breathing, interesting book, much more interesting than I think I would have ended up writing, which would have looked more like a legal brief or a term paper. I want to turn it over now to questions. Thank you for listening, and Wendy, do you want to MC? Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. I know there's probably a lot of questions. Right here. Wait for the microphone, please, because we are recording this so that we can you can listen to, can be podcasted on our website.
I always promise myself I'm not going to ask a question, then somebody says something and I'm inspired. I have two questions. They're unrelated. The first question is, I know you wanted to do this anecdotally and personally, but there's an elephant in the room. Being that there are allegations that the Saudi royal family protected or literally was responsible for people who were responsible for 9/11 for leaving the United States who were there, who were Saudis. Yep. Would you address that? Second, in terms of Israel, what role does Saudi Arabia feel that they want to play in normalizing relationships, changing the situation, rather than just viewing Israel as a permanent adversary?
The issue of the Saudis taking Saudi citizens out of the United States right after 9/11 is something that bothered me immediately as soon as I heard it. I was actually back in Washington fairly quickly for some consultations and had conversations with Bob Mueller and George Tenet about this very, very topic. They made it clear that they knew who every passenger was on the planes. These were mostly kids in college, and they went around picking them up and were given permission to do so, partly because they were afraid of mob violence or other reprisals against them, but they wanted to get them out. They told me they knew who they were available in Saudi Arabia to be interrogated if they needed to be. They talked to a few of them and satisfied me that that was on the up and up. While we're talking about the elephant in the room, there's another element in the book that I deal with that's maybe an even bigger elephant, and that is the allegations that the Joint Congressional Committee report on 9/11 has 28 pages that were I just talked to Senator Graham yesterday about this. He and I have been conversing about it. Allegedly containing information that senior Saudis financed some of the terrorists or their collaborators in the attacks of 9/11. I heard this in 2003 while I was still there as ambassador and said that I needed to see those 28 pages. I said, I can't do my job if I don't know what's in those 28 pages. The CIA said, no, you can't. Sorry, you don't have a need to know. I then said, well, guess what? If you want an ambassador out here, you're going to treat me like an ambassador, and I'm going to see those 28 pages. So finally, they sent this young guy out with a briefcase with the 28 pages. He sat me down in a conference room and passed me one page at a time that I could look at, not copy, but I could look at and read, and I did. Gave them back to him, and off he went. In the book, my initial draft had, in my view, a perfectly benign and sanitized version of what my opinion was about what those 28 pages showed. The CIA redacted that from my draft of my book, and I am left pretty much only with a paragraph in there in which I say those 28 pages need to be declassified. This is where Senator Graham and I agree. He takes the view that there is something that indicts the Saudis in the 28 pages. My view is somewhat contrary to that, but that's all I can say right now. I was encouraged that about 10 days ago, the CIA Inspector General released another classified report on who was responsible within the U.S. government for some of the mistakes made in connection with 9/11. And in their report that has just been declassified, they say that they have found no evidence that any senior Saudis were involved in the financing or execution of the attacks of 9/11. So I think I'm going to have to leave it at that on that point. Going back to the Israelis, in February of 2002, Tom Friedman, the New York Times reporter, was visiting Crown Prince Abdullah and talking to him about his suggestions for a plan to normalize relations with Israel. Abdullah says to him, "Have you been reading my briefcase? I actually have that plan in my briefcase right now, and I'm going to take it to the Arab League meeting in March for passage." And sure enough, he did come up with a plan that's actually very similar to a plan that King Fahd had circulated many years earlier, which suggested normalization of relations, starting with the 67 borders, starting with a notion of a right of return that could be compensated with money, basically, and other elements. But it was a plan that I thought had a lot of substance to it. At the same time, our government was working on what they call the roadmap, which was a very process-oriented document. And so they didn't really give Abdullah as much credit, I think, for that plan as they could have, particularly at the summit meeting in April of 2002. At this point, the plan had been passed by the Arab League unanimously, and it was one of the few times that I think there's ever been unanimity in the Arab League. But they were working on this roadmap. Well, unfortunately, they shared the roadmap with our European allies, but not with the people in the Middle East who it would affect, the Saudis and other Arabs and the Israelis. And so it was leaked by Europeans, and the Saudis are furious, and we lost a lot of traction, I think, at that time in trying to deal with what was another plan to try to make some progress. And so that's about the best I can say about what was happening at that time.
Ambassador, thank you for your appearance and your presentation. I want to follow up my friend's question. Is it a coincidence that 9/11 happens and they're all Saudis, most of them are Saudis, and bin Laden is a Saudi, and Al-Qaeda is a Saudi, al-Nusra and ISIS and Boko Haram, and you've gone and on and on and on. And you said, well, there were some elements that were funding these people.
Yeah.
Has there been any effort to stop the funding?
Oh, yeah.
To stop what's going on? I mean, this seems like it's being fed on and on and on and on, and yet we keep hearing it's Iran that's the aggressor. I mean, it just seems to me that all the funding and all the money that goes on to create all this mayhem and set the Middle East aflame is all coming from Saudi Arabia, and yet no one seems to say, I know we have an enduring friendship, and I appreciate that, and it continues.
Yeah.
But there has to be some elements that are doing this.
Yeah, I'll try to deal with that concisely. Iran is not supporting ISIS. They are an enemy of ISIS. ISIS has also sworn to bring down the Saudi royal family. They want a caliphate based in Mecca, Medina, Baghdad, and Damascus. The Saudis have, in my view, done a feeble job in fighting ISIS. They have done they had a difficult task, and we had a difficult task, in trying to pin down terrorist financing, whether it was Al-Qaeda or ISIS. David Aufhauser, who was the general counsel of the Treasury Department at that time, said that Saudi Arabia is the epicenter of terrorist financing. And I think he's right, but it's in the sense, not in the sense that the government or the senior royals are the ones engaged in it, but that that's where it's happening and that's where it's emanating from, kind of in the same sense that you have a lot of drug trafficking in Miami, but it doesn't mean the mayor or the governor in Florida are in charge of it. And I think it is incredibly important for us to get better at tracking the illegal flow of funds to terrorists. Most of it's in cash. They have hawala networks. They have other ways of getting assets. And it is something that we continue to struggle with. It's a good faith struggle, but it is very, very difficult.
My name is Cammy Bhatt. I'm with the Pakistan Spectator. My question is that impression in Muslim countries, and especially in Pakistan, India, are that nothing important happened in Saudi Arabia without American blessing. Are they really that obedient? And I don't think in this leadership, I mean under President Obama, Saudi Arabia has distanced itself. But before that, I mean when you were there, yeah. Is that true impression that nothing happened there without American permission or without American blessing? Thanks.
Without whose permission?
American blessing.
Position. Yeah. I tell a story in the book about a time when I went to a Saudi dinner party in early 2003, the home of a Saudi, and they start talking about who the next crown prince should be. And there's the hint that Prince Sultan, who was next in line, was not as desirable to some of the younger people in the room as perhaps other younger candidates. And so I started asking them, where does this come from? What makes you think this can actually happen? I said, if you picked Sultan bin Salman or something to be the next crown prince, how would this happen? They said, oh, America can do it. Now, these are well-educated, senior Saudis, some of whom were in government and have served in government. And there was this notion that we could snap our fingers, we could create a new crown prince, we could solve the Israeli-Palestinian issue with a snap of a finger. And this is really one of the things that I learned. I have a section in there about what did I learn from this experience. And one is, we can't do it all. We are not the kind of superpower that can impose our will on things like that. And so I think that's a very good question, but I know that's the attitude. And all you can do is be as humble as you can and try to clear the air.
Hi, Samira Daniels. I'm really glad to hear about your experiences. In light of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, what do you think is the prognosis given the the current political situation, and do you think that people should continue to try to have more formal negotiations in the area?
Yeah, we'll hear that. What's my sense of prognosis for the Israeli-Palestinian issue, and should people have more engage in more discussion?
Yeah.
Yeah. I hate to be a prognosticator with people like John Duke Anthony and Tom Lipman in the room or in the space, but what I would say is this. I think the Israeli-Palestinian issue is probably the most hopeful issue in the Middle East that we have to deal with today, and that isn't saying much. And I say this only half facetiously. We are seeing a catastrophe in the Middle East, the likes of which I could not have imagined. At almost every turn. The Israelis and Iran, oddly enough, have a common interest. I'm sorry, the Israelis and the Saudis have a common interest in resisting Iran's encroachments. That's a positive thing. America, at least at present, also has that same interest. And so there are communities of interest, and I think you're not likely to see permanent alliances in the same way we used to. I think you're going to have transactional alliances, coalitions from time to time. And it's going to be what scholar has called polyarchy. You're going to have different centers of gravity. And so in a way, I think the Israelis will find common cause with the Saudis. You know, there was a rumor 2 or 3 years ago that if the Israelis wanted to bomb Iran, the Saudis would give them overflight rights to fly over the kingdom to deliver their weapons. And I don't know if that was an accurate rumor or not. I do know the Saudis had some interest in talking to the Israelis about their common hostility to Iran. So in that sense, I think there is some room for hope. I think the situation in Gaza, it is not a happy situation at all. It's not happy on the West Bank. But we see at least an economy in the West Bank. We've seen some leadership, but frankly, it has been very, very hard to find on both sides. And so it is polarized, but I go back to saying I think it's not as gloomy as much of the rest of the Middle East is right now. Sad to say. This guy doesn't need a microphone, but go ahead.
Hi, Bob. I'm your friend Greg from Baker Botts, and but I haven't read the book, and it occurs to me that your tenure came at a very interesting time, of course, in the wake of the attacks of 9/11, but also right before the U.S. invasion of Iraq.
Yeah.
And I was intrigued by your comments, not only about the Saudi government, but your reflections on our own government.
Yeah.
Did your service as ambassador, did you have any visibility into the lead-up to our invasion, and do you have any comments in the book on that significant event?
Yeah, the book deals with this in great length. In December of 2002, I visited the president in the White House, and his exact words to me were, "Bob, we're fixing to do a regime change in Iraq." And you could feel, I could just feel something going on within me when he said that. The inspectors still had not finished their job. I was hoping that we would give them time, but it was my job. He said, "I want you to be my point man with the Saudis to get their cooperation for this invasion." And so I went back, and we ended up having a wish list of things we wanted the Saudis to provide for us. We were asking them to do things like close all of their commercial airports, allow the landing of Marine troops at Ras Tanura, the refinery port, and other things like that. But the things that we really needed were the use of Prince Sultan Air Base to launch our tankers and AWACS and support vehicles. We were not launching fighters from there. We did need the use of their air base at Tobruk. Their response to that was, "Okay, you can have it, but we need to put our own F-15 squadron there as a condition to that," which, by the way, was a congressional mandate prohibiting this at one time. We got that solved with Congress. We also needed their assistance in border crossings at Arar on the border with Iraq so that we could send our special forces and others in there and take out radar installations before the invasion and also reconnaissance people there. The Pentagon, the highest levels, kept saying, no, the Saudis are not going to cooperate. Prince Saud was issuing very dire comments at the time. But I was having meetings with Prince Sultan, the Minister of Defense, and his son, and they basically were saying, if you need us, we'll be there. We think you need to figure out how you're going to handle the aftermath, and we haven't heard an explanation of that. But if you need us to help you with the invasion, we're your ally, and we're going to do it. And so all of my cables back were essentially, they're going to be there for us when the time comes. And it was sort of like the old Rolling Stones song, "You can't always get what you want, but you can get what you need." And so they didn't give us the closing the commercial airports or the beach landings and all of that sort of thing. But we got what we needed. And that's something that I tell in the book, and I don't think that story has really ever been told like this before.
One more question? All right, please join me in thanking Ambassador Gordon. Thank you.